We're going to give you guys a test on Nick's talk. So I hope you took notes.
All right. Morning, everyone. I know Michael was here a year ago at the same event and gave 1 hour long speech almost. It's like at this setting, but lengthy, very comprehensive coverage on the status of blockchain. But, you know, our industry is changing really dynamically and rapidly. So let me start by asking you this question. As a famous macro trader and investor, what is your take on Bitcoin's price movement in the past year?
Sure. So let me take you back a little bit on what happened, you know, kind of how we got there, both to the highs of 2017, 2018, and into the crash. And what I think happened is, you know, we had this amazing story. Markets are about stories. And this Satoshi's white paper and then Vitalik's paper, this idea of a decentralized world, this idea of being frustrated with centralized authority, right? Saying this to the central banks and to the big groups that had controlled our data was very appealing. The idea of decentralized finance, democratization of finance, the little guy has a chance to participate, was very appealing. It was such a strong story that it wrapped us all up into it. And so great bubbles happen around stories that are really appealing, but also around stories that really do change the world, right? The internet bubble in the 1990s got way, way ahead of itself, but the internet really changed about everything we did in the world. And so we had the same thing with crypto. And you know, a little bit what happened is Bitcoin, which started off as a decentralized money and kind of morphed into decentralized gold, had a backing. But then Ethereum was the better Bitcoin, and Litecoin was the poor man's Bitcoin. And, you know, there was boxers and movie stars that had their own coins. And pretty soon we had a coin for everything. And the market was unsophisticated. It wasn't regulated. It was unsophisticated. And if you talk any market, if you just collapse supply onto a market, prices collapse, right? And so there was almost unlimited supply as the market got more excited. And we got to 20,000 Bitcoin, like 1,300 in Ethereum, and regulators got nervous because regulators' job is to protect the little guy, and there was all kinds of fraud and excess going on, and little guys being retail investors looked like they were gonna get hurt. And so regulators either slam the brakes or tap the brakes in different jurisdictions. Lots of supply in the market collapsed. And bear markets are painful, right? The market collapsed. Many altcoins were down 99%, 98%. I think Ethereum was down 92% from its high. Bitcoin almost 85 or 90%. So we had a catastrophic bear market. Some people took their toys and went home. Others said, oh, wait a minute, what's happening next? And I think what's really important to understand is that markets get smarter. People fool me once, don't fool me twice. And so people self-regulate and figure out, what do we do wrong? Bitcoin has come back. It's come back far stronger than any of the other cryptocurrencies. And that's because in lots of ways, the story around Bitcoin got tighter. It went from being decentralized money, right? Many people are not going to buy shoes or steaks or suits or pay for services in it, to a store of value, a decentralized gold. And that story took hold. Institutions have bought it for the first time, the Harvard Endowment, the Stanford Endowment, the Yale Endowment, and they're buying it as decentralized gold. We're in a macro environment where $15 trillion of debt trades under zero, where we have trade war between US and China, where we have the reverse of globalization, and so less stability in our global governance system. And so it's a perfect environment for gold, or for the new generation's gold, digital gold. And so the story's clean, and Bitcoin doesn't really need to change to be used as digital gold. Mm-hmm. Nick talked about lack of governance, right? It's hard to change the rules in Bitcoin, and therefore there's a stability to it. And so I tell stories, and when I tell stories to investors, they buy that story. And so I think the outlook for Bitcoin as its own little ecosystem is very strong. More and more organizations are building the piping to allow more people to buy it. And so just last week, the New York Stock Exchange's futures exchange called BACT started. And that was important, and maybe that was why the market went down. There was a lot of expectation that it would start with a lot of volume, and it didn't. But more importantly almost is that they now have a custody solution as well. And so one of the things that has stopped big institutions from coming into this space is custody. They're going to trust the New York Exchange's custody. And just as important, when the SEC looks at an ETF, they want someone they trust to give pricing for six to 9 months. Mm-hmm. Well, if they don't trust the New York Stock Exchange, they're going to trust nobody. And so my guess is 6 to 9 months down the road, we'll have our first ETF because we'll have clear pricing that's trusted from BACT. And so all these things that are adding to the ability to people to unload Bitcoin, given that it's got a halving coming up, given that it's got limited supply, I think the medium term outlook for Bitcoin is very, very positive.
Sounds good. I think Bitcoin's characteristics as a scarce asset, it's a counter-cyclical nature, reverse correlation with cyclical assets. Most of all, the fact that it is liquid with scale has a lot of positive meaning in itself. So
if you think about it, I looked at the last 5 years, there are 40 emerging market currencies, 40, that have devalued versus the dollar more than 40%. From 99% in Venezuela, you know, to 40%. Mm-hmm. So that's a big chunk of currencies, right? If I look at the US dollar in real terms over the last 100 years, it's down 96%, right? And so fiat currencies get debased over time. We're in an environment right now that's actually connecting to people given that rates are so low. And so I literally see this as a hard asset, very similar to gold in the psychology of the investors we speak to. And a great tailwind to be participating.
Right. And, you know, until recently, like you said, you have emphasized the importance of digital assets going to the mainstream institutional investors. Would you share some of your observations on that? Any progress you've observed?
Sure. So listen, I think the way I'm looking at the whole space right now is breaking it into, you know, kind of three buckets. Bitcoin, which we talked about. And then I'll put all the other protocols, Ethereum being by far the leader. You're going to hear from Vitalik, so I won't go too much into what's coming there. But another 30, 40 protocols that are all vying to be either level one solutions or part of the level one solution to build the future economy. The really cool stuff, listen, if this was just Bitcoin and it was just a store of value, okay, it's pretty neat. But the transformational stuff really happens around Ethereum or if one of the other protocols beats Ethereum. That's the good news, is that there's progress being made. The bad news is we all got excited that these things were going to be valued as store of value. And if you look at the periodic table of elements, right, there are 114 elements. Only gold is a store of value just because it is. I think there was something about gold in the ancient times, it came from God, right? The ancient Egyptians and the Aztecs and the Incas thought it was vested with some spiritual power, and it was a shiny metal. The fact that there is no Satoshi recognizable, that he's this mysterious persons, woman. I think Satoshi was a woman. That adds to the mystique around Bitcoin. Let me tell you, the other cryptos have to have a use case, just like copper or any of the other elements on the periodic table need a use case. And so when you start coming up with some valuation metric, even if it's a random, you know, valuation metric, if Ethereum is actually a crypto fuel and not a cryptocurrency, by definition I say, okay, I have fuel times some amount of transactions times price per transaction equals some valuation. So I start coming up with a valuation metric, and it gets harder to dream as big, right? Gold's got an $8 trillion market cap. The whole cloud has less than a $1 trillion market cap. And so what's gonna happen, I think, is the prices of these other protocol tokens are going to go up or down, but not nearly accelerate until we see real progress in the use cases of the protocols. That, unfortunately, is a couple years away. And again, I think Vitalik can give you a better idea than I can, but from all our talking to people in research, you know, this is really a venture bet. It's not a speculative macro bet. Right? Gold is a macro instrument, and most of these things are venture bets. And venture bets are, you know, you make them and you look 6 to 9 years later to see how they are. And so I think the market got very impatient, and liquidity was given to these venture bets way before it should have been given. Now, I do think the one or two protocols that win will also be stores of value. And so the upside potential is spectacular, right? If we're using Ethereum to process this giant blockchain that things are being built on, that payments are being made on, that smart contracts are being written on, and that's the new fabric of our Web 3.0, it's going to have a stunning value, because not only is it going to get valued by the discounted cash flow of its use case, but it's also going to get vested with some money. It will be money, but it's not yet. And so that whole bucket right now, I'm more patient with, but I'm not nearly as long in terms of owning the tokens with. And we see lots of new projects come out with lots of hype, and my instinct is the prices will go down first until they get developers in the box, until they get customers in the box, until they get use cases in the box. That no matter how good the science is, you know, and the programming in a Definity or a Algorand or any of these new projects, if they don't have the numbers of people using them, the price of those tokens are going to come down. Because right now, everything is speculative. In order to keep speculative markets up, you need new buyers. So you need more storytellers. You need more proselytizers. You need to get people to come into the system. Right? That's how speculative markets work. And the energy around the space just doesn't, there's not enough energy to sustain these 50, 60 protocols.
Right. What is your source of belief and confidence on Bitcoin as a store of value? Do you have any sophisticated investors that you observed that you have a confidence that they will deploy the portion of their capital into this?
Listen, you know, when I first got involved, I remember going on TV and people kind of thought I was a little bit of a fool, and there weren't a lot of other guys that had made money outside of the crypto industry talking about crypto. There were a couple, but not many. I now can give a list of 20 people who made over $1 billion in different industries that are giant Bitcoin enthusiasts. Abby Johnson at Fidelity, right? She's not just a Bitcoin, but she's a crypto enthusiast, but she's got, you know, 160 people now working on their project. Yep. Bill Miller at Legg Mason, or was at Legg Mason, now he runs his own funds. Peter Brigger at Fortress. Wences Casares, Mickey Melker. Big names in their own communities, not crypto people, that have huge allocations to Bitcoin. And so, you know, now David Swensen at Yale making a big investment in a crypto venture fund, which is mostly Bitcoin, and Harvard. And so I'm seeing the movement. Jeff Sprecher at the New York Stock Exchange is one of the best CEOs in the world. So there's no longer a debate around, are you going to look foolish in buying Bitcoin? Is it, you know, people have made the decision that it's now an asset. Now, how much of the asset do you want? Are you comfortable with it? Do you need it? Those are big decisions. But it kind of crossed the Rubicon of being an accepted asset.
Let me switch your gear here. You made a contrast just before that Bitcoin as a store of value and other protocols as a sort of an ecosystem build play. I agree. And there may be some, you know, different nature of capital that may be required for the development of each route. And do you see any progress in terms of investors' adoption of this ecosystem-like, you know, EOS, Ethereum of the world?
Yeah, listen, you certainly see some. the decentralized finance apps on Ethereum. We've been investing a lot in video games, esports and video gaming, and I think I last looked, the second largest app on Ethereum was a video game app that we invested in. And so I think the gaming space will be early adopters, and the second big chunk will be payments. I think the Libra Facebook project is the most important thing that got announced. If it happens, we'll see. I hope it does. It credentializes the whole space in some ways. It used to be, oh, cryptocurrencies, can we do them or not? And all of a sudden, not just Facebook, but Visa and MasterCard and Uber and almost every company that they asked said, we want to participate. So they sent a loud and clear message to the regulators and the politicians that cryptocurrencies are part of the future. Now, there were, you know, Facebook entered that thing at the lowest trust level in the company history. And so they went in front of our Congress and the Democrats punched them and the Republicans punched them. And the only thing our two political parties can agree on is how much they dislike Facebook. And so maybe it gets through, maybe it doesn't. But it sent a message that this is, you know, it's, we're no longer debating if cryptocurrency and if blockchain systems are going to be part of the financial and consumer infrastructure of the world. It's just when. I think the next thing to look for, which will be fascinating, is the Telegram launch, which is supposed to happen by the end of this month. I don't think we should have high expectations that it's this awesome blockchain on day one, but they have 310 million users. And so when I talk about getting people into the box and being able to experiment, that will be the first case, I think, where you're going to see the chance for real fast adoption of simple apps built on top of a blockchain. And so that could be a game changer as well.
And you're seeing, you know, investors in a mainstream, in VC, growth equity, start participating in this.
I think that's the big shift. That originally the idea was we were going to fund all these things through token sales because it was this new way of raising capital. We were going to disintermediate the old ways of raising capital. And both regulation, listen, regulation is supposed to help protect retail investors, and it didn't. People bought into crummy projects at crummy levels with zero governance, and they went down and they lost all their money. And so we needed some regulation. I would rather have the market regulate itself with less and clearer rules from the regulators, and that's happening. So rational actors now are saying, these are venture bets. So venture funds like Polychain and Paradigm and a bunch of new ones, Blockchain Capital and Pantera, are raising lots of money from institutions. One of the only good businesses in the last year to be in crypto was being an asset manager raising venture funds because the institutional money says, you guys can't build the new internet in 2 years. This is a 10, 12-year project. And so I'm going to invest in the long run, not the short run.
Sure.
And so it makes, again, the token game, which is, listen, The other good business that has existed is these tokens were synthetic casino chips to provide gambling services for people that love to gamble, right? The Asian community in general, from China to Korea to Japan, love gambling. And so if it's foreign exchange in Japan or with Mr. and Mrs. Watanabe or now crypto, most of the activity in this part of the world was speculative. And the best businesses in terms of profitability, if it's BitMEX or Binance or Wobi, really are providing leverage and access to Asian institutions to gamble on crypto. That I don't think is going away. I just think they're going to be less assets to play with because it's hard to keep liquidity and hard to keep interest in the story. Most of these protocols don't have enough storytellers to keep bringing people in. There's not enough information. And so if you're going to be in the token game, you've got to get the information out. You've got to get new information to get people excited. You've got to build that speculative community. And I just don't think that is the way institutional investors think. And so they're going to be making venture bets.
Yeah, it makes sense. As a macro trader, you are very much focused on, you know, the storytelling, momentum creating. Hopefully, what the protocols are doing, rather than, you know,
sparing their time and energies in storytelling. They are building a real business, and therefore they can prove themselves with...
You know, I always said, there are no speculators that change the world. They just make money. You know, the guys that change the world are guys like Vitalik, who are trying to build the infrastructure to really see the shifts, or like Nick Szabo. You know, my job as an investor is to just understand when that stuff takes off, when the momentum of the story and the capital that flows into those spaces.
Sure.
And so we work with those companies trying to help them think about how to best present themselves.
Right. Your comment on regulation is a nice segue to our next topic, which is asset tokenization or security token. Much hope around it, partially because blockchain's, you know, very natural fit with a domain to replace or supplement the legacy system, possibly getting rid of the inefficient intermediaries along the way. What is your take on it?
Yeah, so listen, I think security tokens is the third big bucket I think about a lot. And in some ways, it's a less sexy bucket, right? It's putting a new wrapper or a new skin over an old asset. In some ways, it allows assets that we didn't think about being able to have broad participation in investing in, things like art or sports memorabilia, tokenized and digitalized and sold off. And so it's probably where the regulators need to focus the most, right? To figure out what structure are we going to allow people, right? In the U.S., we've got some capacity to do security tokens under Reg A. There was one or two done, but there's a very limited ability to do anything big. We're right now working on a giant $700 million real estate portfolio, which is equity interest in a triple net lease portfolio of leases, right? Long-term 20-year leases. And so it trades like a fixed income security. It'll be 7.5% yield. We will sell it under 144A to traditional fixed income real estate buyers. After it seasons in the US for a year, it's tokenized. What does that mean? It means that when the buyer then wants to sell it to someone else, he's got far easier transfer restrictions. He can just sell the token. And that there's some chance that there's liquidity. I think it's a very important transaction, knock on wood, we get it done, because it's the start. It's kind of crawl, walk, run to the mind frame of security tokens. Mm. People are building the infrastructure, right? If you're going to have security tokens, people are going to want to store them somewhere. So it's either the Fidelity custody service or the New York Stock Exchange custody service or BitGo's. We're an investor in BitGo. They're going to need to be able to custody security tokens. They won't have near the liquidity of something like Bitcoin or dollar yen or dollar won. Remember, liquidity goes around objects that people need to care about, that stories can draw them to. Mm. And so, you know, triple net lease real estate will draw some small group to want to participate in it, but not a broad group. And so it should have the liquidity relative to the story it has. But I think it's really important. I do think we're spending a lot of our time trying to figure out what a security token platform should look like. You know, there's four or five projects in the US, Securitized or Templum, that are building these ATS. I actually have a different view. I think that it'll be a pooled sense of, you know, interoperability amongst these exchanges. But there, I'm almost more optimistic that we will have real excitement in that space in the next 2 years, where I think that Web 3.0 space might take longer.
Right, right. I agree. And I have some examples of such progress by the conventional players, very legitimate players in Europe, in Canada. They are working very, very closely with regulators and legislators to basically embrace these blockchain technologies merits to the way that the securities are being traded or even issued. So I'm very hopeful too.
The other thing I would say is when you talk to, so I talked to my friend Joe Lubin at Consensus, who's the big Ethereum ecosystem player. Their business continues to do well in providing services to both state actors and companies on how to implement blockchain solutions. And so the DNA of blockchain is seeping into the world at an accelerating fashion, which is going to make all of the rest of this stuff come together a lot easier.
Sure.
And so I don't want to come across as pessimistic. I think I'm just more realistic and a little bit sober in the short term. And partly because a lot of businesses got built with this expectation that it was going to be as easy as 2016 and 17. And so their cost structure, their business is too high. And then everyone got excited when we had this crypto spring when Bitcoin came way back up. Bitcoin went back up on the enthusiasm around Facebook, on CZ, and what he's building with Binance, and being able to kind of reinvigorate the Asian community. You put those two things together, and it got us a what we thought was a crypto spring, and now it looks like it's a cold spring. And I think there are lots of businesses that need to be rationalized. You'll see businesses go out of business. The good businesses are going to, you know, be able to continue to raise capital to kind of build the future of the space. But it's a more sober view in the short run than what we had, you know, 2 years ago.
Sure. Last but certainly not least, let's talk about some Asian angle. Many of my Western friends do not hesitate to pick Asia as a birthplace of mass adoption case of utility token. What is your view on that? And is it related to your interest in Asia in terms of, you know, deploying your own capital?
Listen, I lived out here 7 years from 1993 to 2000. A lot of you guys probably weren't even born. And so I've always had an affinity. I had my bachelor party in Itaewon. I probably shouldn't tell everyone that. I've had an affinity for Asia. But more interestingly, you know, Asia's fintech business is just way ahead of the US's. If you look at, you know, we have 4 to 5% of payments done on mobile, and China has 90. If you look at the apps, WeChat's just a far superior app than WhatsApp. With the exception of WeChat goes right to the government, and, you know, we hope WhatsApp doesn't. So I think there's just a better history of quick adoption up here. Mm-hmm. I mean, Korea had the greatest internet penetration of any country way before anyone else did. Mm-hmm. And so I think that will probably be once we get scalable apps, we'll probably see them here. Mm-hmm. Same thing with gaming.
Yep. I agree. Asia has the largest young generation population, and they are all tech-savvy, while they are pretty much underserved with a conventional legacy system. So that makes the environment perfect for mass adoption case. With that, let's open it up for questions from the public. Any questions?
We couldn't have been that comprehensive.
Yeah, I should have told you that there will be some time reserved for the questions from the public.
Calling once.
All right.
Twice.
Guys, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Enjoy your time.